I want to speak to you this morning about families. Who loves families? I do. I love families, right? Different churches have got different grace marks. I love families. God loves families. I'll read to you something. It says, it's from a guy called Pastor Shane Montgomery. And it says this, before there were governments, before there were churches, there was family. The very foundation of society is where it all began, the family. In the second chapter of the Bible, God talked about marriage. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. That's found in the book of Genesis chapter 2 and verse 24. Jesus Christ expounded upon this great truth in Matthew chapter 19 and Mark chapter 10 by saying, where they are foul, therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate. So God started it all with the family. He still emphasizes it's important throughout the word in the Bible that whoever finds a wife finds a good thing and they obtain favor from God. In Hebrews 13:14, it says, marriage is honorable in all and the bed is undefiled. That's in Hebrews 13:4. God considered marriage so important in the Old Testament days that newlyweds were not permitted to go to war. So if I was a guy and I just became married and there was war, I didn't have to go to war. Man, I'd be getting married all the time. Wife number one, two, three, avoid war. So you don't have to go to war. Anyway, I don't think you get married, divorce, and you keep going. My wife would shoot me after the first one anyway. Honour thy father and thy mother, that in the days that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord hath given us. That's the first commandment where you see a promise. It's the first of the commands where you see a promise, where it says, honour your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which God has given you. So the Bible makes a promise. If you honour your parents, you live a long life. Jesus repeated the great command in the Gospels in Matthew, Mark and Luke. In Ephesians 6:2, it refers to this as the first commandment with a promise that if you honour your father and your mother, you live a long life. God refers to children as a heritage of the Lord and says that the fruit of the womb is the reward in Psalms 127, verse 3. So we can see that families are very important. Families aren't perfect, but families are important. We need to love families. We need to honour families. We need to build strong families. But Winston Churchill was the leader of, many of you would have known of Winston Churchill. He was a leader of England during the Second World War. He was known for very, very many phrases or many quotes. He was the guy that said, never give up. He went to a school and there was all kids everywhere. And he said, never give up. That's all he said, never give up. Never give up to the kids. That's all he said. And he was just, he had a warrior heart and he just was unable to give in and he said it. But he also said these words, we shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets, we shall fight in the hills. And someone said, it sounds exactly like the family holiday where everybody fights. So families need to be not fighting. God doesn't want families to fight. I trust that's not true for your family. So I want to speak to you today about families and about relationships and about standing one another. I want to have a little bit of fun, but it's a really serious subject. So I want to show you in the Bible, because we find ourselves in circumstances and situations. You know, sometimes our families are where two people have a similar faith and a similar background, and so it's okay. Sometimes you have a family where they're not and there can be tension. But I want to show you in Jesus' name how when we do it our way or our ideas, there can be tension. When you do it God's way, God resolves. God's got a way of resolving things. And there's things you can avoid and things you can't avoid. But I can say to you today with confidence that if you do it God's way, God always brings peace ultimately. Doesn't mean you have to agree with everything that everybody says. Doesn't mean you have to roll over. But when you follow God, it gives you a strength in God's name. So I might be a little bit controversial. But one of the things that you need to understand is that there is a difference between male and female. We all understand that apart from, you know, physically, mentally, there's differences. For example, a man in a bathroom will have six items. He'll have a bath. He'll have a toothbrush. He'll have a toothpaste. He'll have shaving cream, a razor, a bar of soap, and probably a towel. I don't know what it is, but women have about 337 items in the bathroom. There is every cream under the sun. There's all sorts of things. I don't know. It's just amazing. They're just an array of things. Women dressing up. A woman will dress up to go shopping. She'll dress up to water the plants, to empty the garbage, to answer the phone. They'll dress up. A man will dress up when he has a wedding and a funeral. That's about it. Okay. I'm going to help you guys out because I'm going to teach you a new language called womanese. All right? Womanese. So you need to understand between the lines when ladies speak. This is the real definition of words when women speak. When they say fine, it means I am right, the argument is over, you need to shut up. When they say that's okay, right? When they say that's okay, it means it's one of the most dangerous statements a woman can ever make to a man. You young guys need to understand this because you're going to get married one day. When they say that's okay, it's one of the most dangerous statements. It means that she wants to think hard and long before deciding when and how you'll pay for your mistakes. Right? When you ask them and they say, what's wrong? And they say, nothing. And you need to understand, that's the calm before the storm. Right? That means something, and you better be on your toes. Note always that arguments that start with nothing usually end with fine. Right? So you need to be sure. When they say 5 minutes, hey, when are you going to be ready? In 5 minutes, that means that it's a minimum of half an hour, right? It's not 5 minutes. You need to understand that. But don't be mad, but because you're just the same when you've got to take out the garbage and all that. It's never 5 minutes. Okay, what's another one? When they say go ahead, this is not permission. This is a dare, as in go ahead, I dare you. Don't worry about it, I got it, means is the second most dangerous statement a woman can make. It means that a woman has asked a man several times to do something and is now doing it herself. This will result in you asking later, what's wrong? And that takes you somewhere else. So it's different. Men and women are just different. Financially, they're different. You know, if the guys go out, I go out with the guys all the time and I observe things. If I was to go out, say, Frank, Phil and Eugene and Neil, and the bill came to $34.25, each of the guys would pull out $20, throw on the counter and say, keep the change. That's just the way it works. Girls, if you say the same thing, they'd come out with a calculator and they'd work out who pays what and they'd divide the sum thing. That's just the way it is. A woman always has the last word in any argument. Anything a man adds after that is the beginning of a new argument because it's ended. It's just finished. Right, you guys need to understand this. Women love cats. Men do not love cats. When the women turn their back, they kick the cats. So men just don't like cats. With regards to the future, a woman worries about the future until she gets a husband. A man never worries about the future until he gets a wife. That's the other way around. All right, because guys are pretty relaxed and really cool. It's definition of success. A successful man is one who makes more money than can be spent by his wife. A successful woman is one who can find that man. Right, so there's a few. So, of course, they're all silly examples, and of course, they're not true. Of course, some of them are true, some are not true. And I'm sure that the girls will bash me up afterwards, but anyway, I'm 48, who cares? I'm gone soon anyway, so praise the Lord. But the truth is that God is good. And the truth is that we're different. Men and women are different. And you need to understand that. We think differently. We act differently. And if you want to live together, you need to understand that so that you can get on together. In Psalms 127, it says these words, unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat bread of sorrows, for so he gives his beloved sleep. Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth. Happy is the man who has a quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with their enemies in the gate. Let's pray this morning in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you today because you're a great God. Thank you, Lord, that you love us and your word is very clear. And I pray, Lord, that you'll bless us today. Help us to understand how to live with one another in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. So from that verse, we can see if we want a strong, healthy family, and we all do, amen. Everyone wants a strong, let me see those hands. Everyone want a strong, healthy family. If you want a strong, healthy family, you got decisions to make. Your decision is you can either do it your way, right, or you can do it God's way. It's pretty simple. You can look at this stage just very quickly, not at other families. Look at your own and look back at how you've been going for the last 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, and you can ask yourself, not for me, say, okay, how is everything, right? And then you can say, have I done it God's way or have I done it my way? Right? And that's not to make anyone feel bad. The message here is all good. It's to go positive and to go forward in Jesus' name. But to do that, you need to realistically assess, okay, where am I now? Am I living this family the way that God wants me to live it? Am I doing what God wants me to do? Or am I doing it my way, the way that I was brought up, the way that perhaps my parents taught me, or as I saw, the way that my tradition says, the way that my values in my society tells me, the way that all these things do? Or am I living my life? Am I doing the way that God would have me to do? Now, that's a decision that only you can answer for yourself, because the exterior can look one way, but only you know what happens behind closed doors. And I'm not here to criticize or to put down or whatever. I'm just here to present what the Bible says about families. Okay, so I'm here to present. I want to challenge you what the Bible says, because I'm convinced that if you do what the Bible says, that if you live it God's way, God will bless you. The anointing of God will bless you. And we can't live our lives with the exceptions. You need to live your life in the boundaries of the Word, because God is merciful. Who knows that? God is merciful. God does great things in spite of my mistakes. Sometimes God uses people in spite of the wrong things that they do. But you can't say the wrong things that they do that turned out right are the right way of doing it. I know that's a bit of a mouthful, so I'll give you an example. You look in the Bible, you look at someone like David, right? David was very naughty. He murdered the wife of a man that he took and all the rest of it. Later on, that child became the son of the promise. Someone can't reason and say, well, it's okay to murder the husband of another man and take the wife. That's wrong. God in his mercy allowed it in that time, because God's loving and merciful, and God can make any situation turn around and go good, but you can't use that as a precept. You can't do that. You can't, just because it works out right in isolation doesn't mean it's the right way all the time. You know, you look at someone in the Bible, anyone, like Joshua with the Jebusites. Joshua made a covenant with the Jebusites. He shouldn't have done it. He did. But God still blessed him and protected him. You know, so just because something happens in isolation doesn't mean that it's a rule or a guide from there on that it's okay. That's why we need to understand the Bible in its fullness, so we can walk in God's blessing. Because the protection is in the fullness. The wonderful thing is that I'm going to stuff up. I'm going to make mistakes. And when I make mistakes, God is not going to say, beauty, he stuffed up, I can kick them. God doesn't work like that, because God loves you. Can I hear you say, we all know God loves us, amen? Right? People are very cruel. God is not cruel. We all in this church should have the attitude, there go by, but for the grace of God. Because anybody can make a mistake. Anybody can do naughty things. Anybody can do things that shouldn't be right. So on the one hand, we have to have love and mercy and compassion and acceptance for people that do wrong. But on the other hand, the goal is that we walk more and more conformed to the image of Christ. Here we are. This is where we want to be. Here we are. This is where we want to be. Who's got a GPS? Everyone got a GPS? Some people. GPS is funny. They're getting better and better. But with a GPS, if you want to go somewhere, you type in the address, and then it'll tell you where to go. So you're going. And the GPS might say, turn right here. But I know better. Right, so I'm not going to turn right here. So the GPS says, turn right here. And so you keep going. And after a while, the GPS says, you've got to turn right. You miss it. And then the GPS recalculates because I made a mistake. and say, on the third street, turn right and then right. It recalculates your route so you get to the destination where you've got to go. God's grace is a little bit like that. God's mercy is a little bit like that. God's love is a little bit like that. Did I make a mistake? Of course I made a mistake. But God still wants to get me where I've got to go. I might get there a little bit later. I might not get there in time. But the ultimate goal is that we end up into heaven. So every now and then I make a mistake. Now when I make a mistake, I don't carry on and da da da. The more I do that, the less energy I got to do what God wants me to do and to go forward. So, you know, we need to deal with our emotions and we need to deal with how God wants us to go. We all make mistakes. There go I, but for the grace of God, right? Never in this church criticize other people for mistakes that they do. It's not the spirit of Jesus. Jesus always accepted and loved one another. He said, by this will all men know that you're my disciples if you have love one for another. He didn't say, by this will all men know that you're my disciples if you raise the dead, if you do all these miracles, if you do all this stuff that people look for because they want the miracles, they want this, they want all the power, they want this and that. Jesus was God, and he says, this is how they'll know, fair dinkum, that you're my disciples if you love one another. Because people got filters in their head, right? So, for example, if I see two people that are fighting and arguing, carrying on, then the person comes to me, oh, the love of Jesus. I go, I will go. I'm not criticised, but I'll go, well, it ain't working for you. You think it's going to work for me? If people are bang, 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 you know, it doesn't work. So we need to have the love of Christ in our hearts, an atmosphere of loving and acceptance so we can go on. So we see here, 5 points that I want to go through very, very quickly. 5 points. And they're mostly ideas from an author called Balswick, who wrote a book called A Christian Perspective on the Contemporary Home. Right, so this guy's, he put together a manual and he's pretty good. So the first, so there's just a few points I want to draw to your attention. Number one is this. The family is about a covenant, not a contract. The family, your relationship with your family is a covenant and not a contract. What's a contract mean? A contract is if you do this, I'll do that. If you do this, I'll do that. God doesn't have a contract with us. He's got a covenant. I've written down here the logical, actually I didn't write, I copied it from this guy. Right? It says this, the logical beginning point of any family relationship is a covenant commitment, which is an unconditional love at its core. Out of the security provided by this covenant love develops grace. It is this in this atmosphere of grace, family members have the freedom to empower each other. Empowering means to lead. It's the possibility of intimacy. So when we have families, if you're a father, your kids, whatever, we need to have a covenant relationship. It's not, if you do this, then I'll do that. You have to learn to love unconditionally. Why? Because Jesus loved us. Just on Sunday night, I went with Safwat, and we went to the church, a beautiful Arabic church just around the corner. And I spoke to them on Genesis chapter 15. And if you look at Genesis chapter 15, you have the covenant between Abraham and with God. And at the beginning of Genesis 15, we see that God says, Abraham, I'm going to bless you, da da da, and you're going to be the father of many nations. And Abraham goes, God, that's great, but I've got no kids. God, that's great, but I need kids. I've got no kids. What good is all that if all the blessing will go to my servant, Eliezer? It won't go. And so Abraham had a very honest relationship with God. A lot of people don't. We need to develop an honest relationship with God where we can say, but God, it's a relationship. It's a two-way relationship. And so, cut a long story short, because I don't want to focus on this, but I want to show a point of it, is that God does a covenant with Abraham. And this is the difference between religion and Christianity. And the covenant with Abraham was this. In those days, when a king made a covenant with another king, what they would do is they would say with the king, they would say there'd be a greater king and a lesser king. And what they would do is they would get animals and they would cut the animals in half. So they would get an ox and whatever, and they would put half the animal here and half the animal over there. Then the king would get another king, all right? He's a little king, I'm a big king, like as in stature, not that. But anyway, praise the Lord. And so then they would hold hands, And then they would walk through the pieces together, right? So the dead cow is that side, and they would go, it's all right, I'm not that way inclined, right? I'm just holding your hand, right? Relax, right? You can sit down, it's okay. You're wearing a pink shirt, mate, not me. Anyway, a purple shirt. Oh, crumbs. Anyway, so that one didn't go down well, did it? Anyway, they walk along through the animals, right? I got to get the moment back. So they'd walk along through the animals, and so what they would say is, if anyone attacks you, I will defend him. I will defend you. Your enemy is my enemy. Right? If anyone attacks me, your job is to protect me. That's the covenant. And they would walk through it together. And then they would say, and if I fail to protect you, may I become like these animals, cut in two on the ground. So they were taking on a contractual covenant agreement, because if he failed to do it, he would end up like the animals. That's what he was saying. I'm in this to the death. I'm protect you, you protect me. If I don't, if I renege, it's not like, oh, I don't feel like going today, I'm a little bit tired. You're going to end up like that. A lot of people think of church like that. They think, oh, is God going to bless me? Oh, I didn't pray today, the blessing of God's not on me. Oh, I didn't read my Bible today. Oh, blessing of God's not on me. See, that's a traditional, that's not a relationship. You know, a father loves a son, loves a daughter. It's not like that. Unconditionally, they love. And so the love is always there. But a lot of people think religiously, if I'm naughty, the love of God doesn't come on me. God loves you. Nothing you can do can stop the love of God. However, Abraham, if you read later in the story in Genesis chapter 15, the Bible says that God puts Abraham to sleep. Right? In Genesis chapter 15, it's in the Bible. Don't trust me, read it. He puts him to sleep. And then the Bible says that God came through in the form of a smoking pot, like his presence was there. And it says that God passed through the pieces on his own. He didn't go with Abraham. God passed through on his own. What does that tell us? That tells us that God knew that Robert could never, ever keep his part of the covenant, because Robert is flesh and blood and Robert is weak. Robert is susceptible. Robert does mistakes, big mistakes. Robert is sometimes good, but sometimes he's naughty, under pressure. Robert does mistakes. Maybe you're a little bit like that. And so he knew that if I was to walk through God side by side, he knew that we would fail him. That's why it's not a contract, it's a covenant. That if any man comes, that's why in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, I always say this verse, that's why it's always, for by grace you've been saved, through faith, not as a result of works, lest any man should boast. It's the grace of God. It's the grace of God. So we all have a religious perspective. Oh, I didn't come to. Do you have to come to church? Of course you've got to come to church. But you don't come to church to get the blessing of God. You come to church because you love God. Do I give money so that I get money? No, that's ridiculous. Does God need your money? The answer is no. But it's a blessing for you. God, you work in the, you operate in the blessing, and you see testimony after testimony of the blessing of God. So it's not that God doesn't love you. God loves you. It's about operating in his grace. It's about operating him, but he still loves you. He still loves you. And so he knew that we would fail him. Otherwise, we've got a religion. We don't have Christianity, because it's all works-based. I'm good, so God's going to bless me. I'm bad, God's not going to bless me. It doesn't work like that. If it was like that, we'd all be dead by now. Right? And so we need to understand that. So it's not a covenant. It is a covenant. It's not a contract. It's a covenant. So we need to understand that. It's not like Facebook. Facebook these days, with Facebook, I like to go on Facebook every now and then. With Facebook, if you don't like someone, you just unfriend them. It's just a little button. You go, like that. Some people here, I reckon on their Facebook, the jolly computer, the key on that part has been worn away. Unfriend, friend, friend. God's not like that. You're in with God, a friend for life. Amen? You don't sound convinced. Amen? Good. Because God loves you. He's for you. Number two, we spoke a little bit about it, is grace. It's not law. to forgive and be forgiven. Family relationships are designed by God. Family relationships as designed by God are meant to be lived out in an atmosphere of grace, not the law. In Ephesians 4:32, it says these words, "And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ forgave you." Just as God in Christ forgave you. There's a verse in Mark 10, it says, "And when you stand praying, forgive if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father in heaven can forgive you." Now that's easy to say and very hard to do, because sometimes people really hurt you. So I'm not being flippant about that. I know people can be very horrible and that, but it's one of the eternal principles of God where in your heart we need to forgive, because if you forgive, you will not be the slave. While ever you can't forgive, you need to understand that you're the slave, because that circumstance rules you. It rules your emotion. You can't let it go. And so you need to learn to forgive, and you need the grace of God. I mean, people mess up, but you know, in my family, everyone messes up. It's okay. But you need to love one another unconditionally. Otherwise, it's just not good. I've got a little quote here from a guy called W.G. Knight. It's an illustration on grace. It says this: "When a person works an 8-hour day and receives a fair day's pay for his time, that is a wage. When a person competes with an opponent and receives a trophy for his performance, that is a prize. When a person receives appropriate recognition for his long service or high achievements, that is an award. But when a person is not capable of earning a wage, can win no prize and deserves no award, yet receives such a gift anyway, that is a good picture of God's unmerited favour. That is what we mean when we talk about the grace of God." So we need to understand God's grace, and we need to live it out. You need to live it out in your family. It doesn't mean you don't have rules. I mean, I'm a rule Nazi, so I love rules. But you still have to have grace of God on top of that. And grace has to be more. Because God, it's not a license to do anything, right? There has to be boundaries. If you love, there's boundaries. You need to be, point number three is you need to be empowering, not possessive power. You need to serve and be served. In Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, this is one of my most favorite promises in the Bible. It says this: "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." I've seen this happen so many times, where you've got kids that grew up in church, and for whatever reason, they leave the Lord. But you know what? They come back. If you do, that's a big responsibility for parents. You decide. Train a child. Will you dare to train your child in the way they'll go? Because it's not a flippance. I care about your children too much to just say, "She'll be right, mate." It won't be right. Because I've seen kids not. It's not right. It's effort. It's time. It's decisions. It's all these sorts of things that you need to do. It's not, "Oh, she'll be right." It won't be right. That's your kid you're talking about. So you need to put time, you need to put effort, and you need to love. You need to invest in this thing. You need to understand, a true parent, it's more about the child than for you. I see this with you. I could tell story after story after story in this place of parents that are just selfless, where they love their children, they put their lives on hold for their children. You guys all do it. And that's to be commended in balance. And that's wonderful, but you need to make sure that God comes first in all of that equation. And not God in your eyes. You need to make sure that when your kid knows that, he knows that God is first. And it's something that, you know what, you can teach a lot of things, but I find a lot of the things of God are more caught than taught. Do you know what I'm saying? You can say them to you black and blue in the face, but if I say, honor the house of God and all that, and then I don't honor the house of God, then, I can say whatever I want. The kids are going to go, I was listening to this pastor preaching one day. He says some people, they go to church and then they have pasta for dinner. It's not pasta as in food, it's pasta as in the minister, because they're talking bad about the church. Thank God we don't have like that here, praise the Lord. Well, not that I know of anyway. But no, you guys are great. I know you guys are great. But we need to protect against that sort of stuff. Because a critical spirit is like cancer to your soul. And so if not for your sake, for your kids' sake, never go down that line. Just don't go down there. It's all pain. I've seen it. I've seen people like that. Their kids grow up like that. You grow up under that and your kids. So you need to make sure that you need to have grace in your life. You need to empower them and not be possessive. There's another verse in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 to 7. Says these words, and these words which I commanded you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. That's Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 to 7. So we need to do that. We need to make sure that we don't empower people, because empowering doesn't work. If you... with kids, sooner or later, they'll break the yoke because it's just oppressive. It's not right. And, you know, we can make mistakes. And parents can make mistakes. But love keeps them together all the time. And so I would encourage you parents, and not only parents, between husband and wife. Some men got a long way to go. You know, I believe... You know, the Bible says man is the head of the home. And I don't mean that offensively. I think a lot of the big issues today is that there's not godly men that stand up. You know, we need to do it. I'm particularly hard on the men because you guys are the kings. You guys are the priests in your family. And like if you got to lead so people will follow. And because there's a godly balance. I'm not talking about what Robert says. I'm talking what the Bible says. And that doesn't put women down. That actually elevates them to where God wants them. I think ladies should not be just barefoot and pregnant. I think that's rubbish. I think they should be the best of the best. I think they should be the best in their jobs. They should be the best in whatever they do, the best in their families, the best in whatever God wants. But always within the context of where God wants them to be. And if they're married with a godly husband, if they're not married, praise the Lord, it doesn't really matter. But you need to be, it doesn't mean you're barefoot and pregnant in some corner, uneducated, just doing this and that. You need to honestly follow what God wants you to do. And if it's that, praise the Lord. Don't undervalue that or say that's more important than another person that has chosen another path. Because it takes everybody together. Can I hear you say amen? That's why we need to love one another and appreciate one another and have respect for one another, whatever your calling is, whatever your place that God is, whatever your calling is, that's what you need to do. You know, a person that works as a tradesman is not any better than a person that's got a university education, is not better than anyone that doesn't have any education, because they're all used of God. Can I hear you say amen? So like in this place, you can't do that. You've got to love everybody. Love everybody, because it doesn't matter. Society labels. Society says, oh, you're fat, you're skinny, you're tall, you're short, you wear this, you wear that, you live in this postcode, you got this car, you got this house, you got this, you do this sport, you follow this team, blah, 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 all this sort of stuff. And all they are is tags that the world puts on you because they want to label you. I'm not interested in that stuff. We're interested in how God labels us. Can I hear you say amen? Because that's more important. And part of that is loving one another. I mean, you're not naive. You've got to see stuff. I think you should be the best. If God's called you to be a mum, you be the best mum in the entire world. You do what it is that God's called you to do in the best of your ability. You know, if God's called you to work in the corporate world, then you be the best in the corporate world. You destroy the works of the enemy and you do what God's called you to do with every bit of fiber and passion and vigor that you got in Jesus' name. If God's called you for the sporting field, you play to the best of your ability. I was going to say destroy the enemy. It's not a fight, right? But you do whatever it is so that what you do the best, the absolute best. You know, you're educated, whatever it is. God wants you to be the best at what you are, whatever it is. Because it's not about where you are. It's about how God sees you. So you need to understand that. We need to get into there. You need to be close with your family. You need to be intimate with your family. Not distance. Some people like to put up the walls. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 25, it says, speaking of Adam and Eve, it says, and they were both naked, the man and his wife, and they were not ashamed. Right? Now, I'm not saying I want everyone to take their clothes off, right? We're not that dumb, right? I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is, though, that Adam and Eve stood completely open and transparent before God. And it was only after their disobedience that they tried to hide from God out of feelings of nakedness and shame. The intimacy which Adam and Eve felt was an ability to be themselves without any pretense. So in the context of your family, you need to be able to be who you are without any shame. You can't, you know, some people, you go around them and it's like you've got to always walk on eggshells. Do you know what I mean? Well, can't say that, can't say this. Ooh, if I go there, whoa, the reaction, it's always on eggshells. You know, not good for heavy blokes like me because I tend to step on a few eggshells. No, but some people are like that. Don't be like that. Be a gracious person. In your family, your parents, kids, create an environment where you can lovingly be who you are and love one another in Jesus' name, because that's what you got to do. I'm going to close with a verse. They're up there, the next one, in Ephesians chapter 5 from verse 21. You know, I showed these verses to the boys just before, and I won't say the names, but they said, oh, Rob, can you pull out verse 21 and verse 25? And I said, no. Verse 21 says these words. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21 says these words. Submit to one another in the fear of God. Okay? So submit to one another. So husbands and wives in the family, submit to one another. That's not the guy says, you will do as I say. Growing up, I've seen a few guys that say, you will do what I say. It doesn't work, fellas. Right? You might feel like a superhero for a sec and think you're tough. It doesn't work. Right? It doesn't work. Right? Because Jesus doesn't do that. Let's look at the context of this. These are the verses that people usually don't like to preach. Right? Verse 22, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the saviour of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Verse 25, though, this is the crunch. It says this: husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her. So, and that's one of the big problems today, because a lot in a godly relationship, you need to work out the dynamics. How much did Jesus love the church? Jesus lived a selfless life. Jesus died for the church. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. So the whole life of God was for his church. He did everything for the church. He empowered the church. He wanted the church. And in the same way, the relationship between husbands and wives need to be the same, where you love one another. It's not a context. You just have different offices. You have different places, different positions in it. And I don't mean that in a bad way. I think it's the most empowering thing that a person can do is to understand in their lives God's grace for them. So there's no fighting. So there's no dynamic. You know, women have wives have got the ability to make their husbands feel like either supermen or super idiots. They're not really, I'll give you, most men don't really care too much about what other people say on the outside. But a man, to everything to him is how much and how encouraging and the relationship between his wife, he'll do anything. And ladies are exactly the same. So you need to understand, I don't want to make this a marriage seminar, that's for another time, but the Bible says, husband, love your wives, in verse 25, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself to her, so that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word. In verse 27, that he might present her to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Verse 28, so husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. Now that doesn't tell me that that men be bullying or intimidating or get my lunch or get this or get that. That's not godly. It's just not right. You don't tell what to do. Because there's love one for another in Jesus' name. So husbands ought to love their wife as their own bodies. For he who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh and of his bones. For this reason, verse 31, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery in verse 32. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular say, love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. So we see here, wives to submit and respect their husbands. Husbands are to unconditionally love their wives just as Christ loved the church. And so that's the godly, divine order that God put in. And that's what we need to, as a church, espouse and go on. For children as well, it goes on in verse 1, Ephesians 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents when they give you lots of toys and pocket money. Doesn't say that, does it? Children, obey your parents when you feel like it. Doesn't say that either. It says, children, obey your parents, for this is right. In verse 2, it says, honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise. So, you know, today, what are some of the things that the devil tries to undermine today? Certainly the relationship between father and son, mother and daughter, parents and children. Overall, people need to love and to respect and to honor the family unit. Now, that doesn't mean that you agree with everything that is said. I mean, I don't agree with everything that my father says all the time. Man, if you get us on a job site together, it's a disaster, right? I would never work on a job site with him. But I still love him and respect him with all my heart. You know, in the things of God, I love him and respect. I love my family. I love my children. I love everybody. Because there's ultimate respect there. You need to understand that. It says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. That's a promise, newsflash. That's a promise of God. And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath. Got to work on that a bit, right? But bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. So for you young kids growing up in the church, you need to respect your parents. Now that's not a bad thing, that's a good thing. Because we are God's people. So sometimes do kids always think their parents are right? The answer is, well, you kids are too good. I was expecting everyone to stand on seats and say no. Right? But the reality is that sometimes as kids, we think that the parents are wrong. Right? And that's the truth. Newsflash, it's happened ever since day one generation. Until Jesus comes back, it's going to happen. Because you guys are young, we're old, you know, whatever. There's always going to be tension. But never allow yourself to disrespect your parents. There's a line that you don't cross. There's healthy discussion. Right, and people can make mistakes, but you need to respect your parents all the time in Jesus' name. Because if you do, the blessing of God falls on you. You walk in the promises of God. You look at the rebellious and you look at the not rebellious and the blessing of God. So in your homes, don't get involved in the arguments and the fights. It's ridiculous. Don't do that. Just honor God. Let his presence be there. Fathers, make sure you don't provoke your kids. Sometimes very hard if you've got a stirring character like me. But you've got to not do that. You need to just do things in God's order, in God's way. Because these are not my thoughts. These are biblical thoughts, right? As spoken through. So you need to challenge them. You need to look at them. Because one of the things that I pray for all the time is strong families. Strong families. Strong families, you need to make the choice. Fathers, in Jesus' name, you got a very great responsibility. Mothers, in Jesus' name, you got a very great responsibility. Children, in Jesus' name, you got a great responsibility to do what God wants you to do. Every head bowed, every eye closed. We're going to close this morning in Jesus' name. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your goodness, your kindness, and your mercy today. We thank you, Lord, for the power of your word. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you forgive us, Lord, where we may have said something wrong or not had anything right. But we thank you for your word that is full of power and integrity. We thank you, Lord, even for difficult subjects sometimes, Lord, that you open up our eyes to understand, Lord, what comes from man and what comes from your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray, Lord, for every person, Lord, that's a member of this church, Father. Lord, that their families, Lord, would be blessed and they would be healthy and that they would grow. Father, we thank you, Lord, for all the families, Father. And we pray, Lord, that your anointing, your blessing would fall upon them. We pray for those that are hurting, oh Lord, or those that perhaps are going through a difficult time, Lord. And Lord, I pray, Father, Lord, that your mercy and your grace would be with them, that you would anoint them. I pray for the young people as well, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, that they would grow strong and in your power. We give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.